The founding fathers looked to this great man with respect. He wrote the commentaries on the law, and it was read as widely in America as it was in England. Commentaries on the law. Let me just quote one statement from it to give you a small sample. Man as a creature must necessarily be subject to the laws of his creator. This will of his maker is called the law of nature. No human laws are of any validity if contrary to this.
Let me introduce to you our luncheon speaker. Steve Pratt is a rancher and a craftsman and a businessman, and he's been a teacher with his wife and four children. Steve lives the life America has promised, a life of his own. In fact, just talking to him as we begin ready up here, Steve, you're having way too much fun in life. One of his passions is creating reproductions of antiques. He builds them. And he builds time period correct printing presses, one of which he just delivered to Philadelphia for the Ben Franklin Printing Office. The federal government is now using this very correct printing press. It's the same as the original Constitution was printed on. They're now printing the Constitution in this print shop, and Steve built that press. Above all, Steve loves the Constitution and has devoted much of his life promoting it and teaching its virtues to new generations. He spent 7 years traveling the nation and into foreign countries, working with the great constitutional scholar Cleon Skousen and the National Center for Constitutional Studies, who are here today. Today, he is going to share with us how a North American union will infringe on our constitutional rights. Please welcome Steve Pratt.
Delighted to be here. Last year I had the privilege of speaking at the luncheon, and I thought, how will they listen while they eat? And this year I think it's a delightful idea. Nobody went to sleep last year. And so go ahead and nourish your bodies. Don't worry about looking up so much, but there will be pictures coming on the screen, and they'll be fast moving, so you might spill a little on your shirt. That's okay. We'll forgive you for that. I am going to speak on a subject that I need to introduce slightly, and I'm going to introduce it with a fire. Last year, I had a slide on the screen that showed a great big smoky fire coming down upon my house. Well, about 1 week ago, I was in Philadelphia delivering a printing press to the U.S. government printing office. Now, that's exciting in itself, and one of my friends recently told me when I got back, he said, it's the first thing the federal government will have been done right for a long time. They're going to print the Constitution of the United States in Benjamin Franklin's grandson's printing office in downtown Philadelphia, right around the corner from Independence Hall. So for the tourists, they will see it done right. But while I was in my truck then, coming out of Pennsylvania, my son and I flipped on the radio to get the evening news. And I don't know if you caught it. Did you say where I live? I live in Cove Fort, Utah. And on the evening news in Pennsylvania, we hear live from Cove Fort, Utah, the biggest fire in the history of the state. And it went right around my house. Okay? It covered 500 square miles. It was terrible. Burned hundreds of livestock and buildings. And it was on the news, and my son and I see it there. And I thought, well, that's fitting. Here we are out here, we can't fight that fire, and we're fighting another one. So I hear about these things that are happening here at this convention. We hear about the Texas corridor and the different things that are coming up. These are wildfires. All these political things that we're battling, and we have to battle them. Somebody has to. I want you to try, like I asked last year, to look beyond the haze and smoke. See if you can see past the wildfires that you're battling and look at something that's much nearer and dear that we must preserve also. And they've asked me specifically to address the topic of natural law. This old concrete block garage was wore out when I first walked up the driveway.
This was like about 27 years ago. My neighbor asked me to go to a class. I was already educated, and he wanted me to go to another class to learn something. Why, I had a master's degree from a leading university. Why, I'd done graduate studies at the University of California, at Berkeley, in the 60s. I was educated. And still this neighbor thought I ought to go and listen to some old professor who I'd never heard of before, and he was going to talk about the Constitution. What a boring subject. Well, the neighbor was persuasive, and finally, good neighbor, and honest, I'm serious, this was a turning point in my life, and I will thank my Heavenly Father till I die for this wonderful man, for the invitation to come and listen about our heritage. And so he took me up the driveway. He picked me up. He took me up this driveway into this old concrete block through that aluminum storm door you see up there on the screen. That old door, rattly old thing, dusty inside. Who in the world would ever go here to get their education? I had graduated from a university with marble pillars and polished walnut paneling on the walls. And now I'm in this dusty old hole where they moved the ping pong table over and swept some of the dirt aside, set up cold folding chairs, and they said, here's where we're going to study American history. Well, it was that night that I met this grand old gentleman. He was old. He was as old then as I am now. And I looked at him and I thought, boy, what an old codger. Tummy was big, head was bald. What'll I learn from him? It was the first time in my life I ever heard American history taught at the field level. He had a love for it in his heart and he wanted to share it. He was there for no other reason. There was no glory in being in this old dusty garage. An old retired professor that wanted to share the message, and he called it Our American Heritage and the Constitution. That was the name of it. Well, I went in skeptically, and 3 hours later, that's 3 hours without any visual aids, no chalkboard even. 3 hours later, I went up to the front to shake his hand and introduce myself, and I remember saying something like this, I don't know who you are, and you don't know me, but what do I have to do to teach for you? Wow, I'd had a special evening. I felt something about my country for the first time in my life. You felt it too, I can tell you were there at another meeting like it. Wow, okay, well he said this was the answer. Do your homework. Oh, I have to do something. Yeah, 2 years later, 2 years of following this theme and subject and listening to many lectures and reading many, many books and materials he handed me, 2 years later he said, why don't you come to work for me? I says, well, I can't. Why not? I don't have a suit. He got out his checkbook and wrote out a blank check. He handed me a blank check and he says, you go to the suit store of your choice and buy a suit and get to work. We've got a country to save. And for the next 7 years, I worked full time for this grand old man. I traveled all over the United States. But I want to tell you about the first assignment, and that's my topic for today. I was assigned. He called me into the office and he said, find out everything you can about what Thomas Jefferson meant. What is the meaning of the phrase, the laws of nature and of nature's God? And at that time, I thought, well, gee, that might take all afternoon. So I thought, let's see, where do I start? So laws of nature. Now, I was supposed to be a trained researcher, and I better start at the law library. I'm going to study the laws of nature. I go to the law library. And it was a good choice. And for the next 6 weeks, I pursued the laws of nature and of nature's God in a major university law library. When I had exhausted every possible source in that library, I went to the next university's law library and did it again. Didn't take 6 weeks the next time. There wasn't that much different material. And just a few days ago, I reviewed my published notes at that time. They were published under the title, The Rise and Demise of Natural Law. And I counted 37 different great scholars that I had used as resources during that study of natural law. This was incorporated into our first book, The Miracle That Changed the World, The 5,000-Year Leap. Now, just last year, we reprinted it special for last year's Freedom 21 conference. And during the year, we sold 10,000 of them. But our goal now is 100,000. And so we'll say a little more about this book and what the content is. I'm going to introduce you to the first principle. But notice there's something special about the cover. This wasn't the original cover. We decided we had to have a rising sun on the cover. So there is the rising sun. The first principle. Now, the book contains the 28 great principles that our founding fathers applied in making America the greatest nation in the history of the world. The first principle, the only reliable basis for sound government and just human relations, is natural law. And I studied for 6 weeks in the law library, and the other students were starting to wonder why I was there since I didn't attend the classes. And several of them asked me, why are you here? I said, I'm studying natural law. Oh, you mean water resources and timber industry and coal? No, natural law, like Thomas Jefferson spoke of when he wrote the Declaration of Independence, and a blank look would come on their face and they wouldn't understand. They had no concept of what I was talking about, and they were students of law. Natural law is the very foundation for American constitutional government. Without it, you have no constitution. A few weeks ago, we invited a Baptist minister to come and speak at one of our conferences. We call our conferences Liberty and Learning. I put them on all over the United States. Our guest was a Baptist minister from Pensacola, Florida, named Chuck Baldwin. You've heard of him. A great speaker and a wonderful asset for us in Utah. He called our attention to this scripture. For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, do by nature the things contained in the law, these, having not the law, are a law unto themselves, which show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness. Jeremiah then also was noted, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts. Now with his assistance and direction to this beautiful scripture, my mind was opened, and I went to John chapter 1 verses 1 to 9 and summarize it with these words: the Spirit of Jesus Christ gives light to every person that comes into the world. Humbly pray unto God in your heart to know the truth of the things which I am saying or telling you today, and if they are true, he will speak peace to your mind concerning these matters. These were treasures that I gained on that evening listening to this humble man. Now I call your attention to this book. How many have read it? Oh my goodness, we got to have an advertisement program. We're not selling it here. I haven't seen it back there, but I'm thrilled. Two people raised their hand. This book was a light as this man shared the light of Jesus Christ and presented his story. Just as Judge Roy Moore in Alabama, the Ten Commandments judge, recently fired from his position as Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Alabama because he refused to take the Ten Commandments out of his building. But he says it wasn't the Ten Commandments. He refused to stop acknowledging the sovereignty of God. That's what he refused to do. You can hang the Ten Commandments as long as they have no religious significance. But you can't acknowledge the sovereignty of God unless you want to be fired. That's what he found out. His book's an inspiration. Here's another great inspiring man that has shared with us some of the light of Christ. Betrayed by the Bench by John Stormer. How many of you read this one? Okay, see four or five hands go up. Excellent reading. I smuggled into my suitcase and brought 10 weapons with me on the airplane coming down. 10 weapons that are more violent than a handgun. That's 10 books from John Stormer. And I got through security with them. And they're back on the table. Wow. I don't want 10 people now to commit themselves. Who will take one of John Stormer's books? They're 10 bucks a piece. Come on, let's see 10 hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We got them. Zeldin, hold them for those 10. I don't know who they are, but they'll come back. Okay, John Stormer is very worthwhile reading. Now notice Betrayed by the Bench. What bench is this that betrayed us? I'm going to show you a picture of a bench. This is a bench. Now, a bench is where the legal process takes place in a courtroom. Here we have a distinguished judge behind the bench, and in the front we have a lawyer trying to argue his case. But this distinguished judge is just not any judge. He's a judge with a special hairdo. He's an English judge. And in England, during that time period, the judge always put on a wig. So here we have this special judge, but he was special in America also. The founding fathers looked to this great man with respect. He wrote the commentaries on the law, and it was read as widely in America as it was in England. Commentaries on the law. Let me just quote one statement from it to give you a small sample. Man as a creature must necessarily be subject to the laws of his creator. This will of his maker is called the law of nature. No human laws are of any validity if contrary to this. Do you get the magnitude of that? Suppose your legislature gets together and they decide a certain thing and they say, this is a law. Let's suppose it was a law to abolish sodomy and rule sodomy as against the laws of the state of Texas, for example. Now, is that an appropriate law that is in harmony with the laws of the great legislator of the universe? Yes, it is. But let's suppose a higher court comes along, the Supreme Court of the United States, and says, you can't do that. Sodomy is legal. And they authorize sodomy. Is that within the jurisdiction of the law? No. No, so when this man speaks, no human laws are of any validity if contrary to the laws of nature and of nature's God. Another great hero of the past was Marcus Tullius Cicero. And the founding fathers loved and respected his writings. He wrote, true law is right reason in agreement with nature. The animal which we call man, endowed with foresight and quick intelligence, complex, keen, possessing memory, full of reason and prudence, has been given a certain distinguished status by the supreme God who created him. For he is the only one among so many different kinds and varieties of living beings who has a share in reason and thought, while all the rest are deprived of it. And reason, when it is fully grown and perfected, is rightly called wisdom. This is great thinking. By the way, these are quotations from the first section of the 5,000-year leap. You can read the rest of the story there. There's one more I don't want to bypass from Cicero. A legislative majority may pass laws that contradict the natural law, but these no more deserve to be called laws than the rules a band of robbers might pass in their assembly. Isn't that great? Now, we have the rule of law established in America by our founding fathers. Let's define this in more detail because we hear the rule of law, this phrase thrown out somewhat incorrectly by current leaders of the nation. The rule of law. This building is the first Supreme Court building in the United States. And the first Supreme Court, for the most part, was trying to live by the principles established under the rule of law. Here is a definition that would help us here. Rule of law. Because the United States is a constitutional republic, both the people and their elected leaders observe the limitations imposed by a written constitution, which is solidly founded on the laws of nature and of nature's God. Now that's an accurate definition of the rule of law. Now, is there any other definition? Today, George Bush has declared that the North American Union is being established under rule of law. Is there any truth in that? No. I'll tell you what the difference is. We have rule of law, but today we have rule of lawmakers. And that's entirely different. The natural law is completely abandoned, has been for many years, and the rule of lawmakers is the present trend. Here's the definition of the rule of lawmakers. We're reading now directly from the Department of Army Field Manual, June 1952. This is what the soldiers were supposed to believe about American government. Because the United States is a democracy, the majority of the people decide how our government will be organized and run. The people do this by electing representatives, and these men and women then carry out the wishes of the people. Can you believe that? Many people do. This is what's taught in every high school and university in the country. This is the current teaching and claim that America is based upon. The rule of lawmakers undermines moral and religious values. The rule of lawmakers rewards sloth, promotes pornography, sodomy, and abortion, abolishes national boundaries, destroys the peace of the land, undermines the right to private property, redistributes the wealth, promotes greater private and public debt, and ignores all constitutional limitations. Does any of that sound familiar? How did we evolve from rule of law to rule of lawmakers? Now get ready, this next one's going to be kind of shocking. I don't want it to disturb your meal. I'm going to show you a picture of your great-great-grandmother. That's this next slide. This is to teach you. I'm going to guide you through this understanding. How did we evolve from rule of law to rule of lawmakers? That's your great-great-grandmother. Now what is that? That's a bunch of slime. That's a bunch of slime. But what does that have to do with our law? Everything. Everything. Is that you, Grandma? Now, when I went to high school, this is what they showed me. Not only when I went to high school, that's what they're showing in the local high school in my community today. Have you ever seen this in your school textbooks? If you haven't, you haven't looked at the textbooks. This is where man originates. Man is nothing but a product of random chance coming from some distant, infinitesimally long time past. It was explained to me like this. A long time ago, there were particles floating around in space, and two of them bumped together. And they fell down into a tepid primeval sea. And after eons of infinite time, a lizard crawled out from under a rock. And that was your great-great-grandmother. Have you ever heard this story? It's taught in every high school and university in the land. Now, I went to the prison several different times by assignment to do research there. And I became a friend with one of the inmates who was an artist. And one time I asked him, would you sketch me a drawing of someone who looks like he thinks he's a scum? When I used to go to high school, when we wanted to call somebody a really bad name, we'd call him a scum. You dirty scum. Well, they think of worse words now, but that was what we used then. That was a bad word. And so I said, draw me a picture of a man that thinks he's a scum. Oh, he says, you just want me to draw a common street criminal, don't you? And so he drew the common street criminal. And here's the improved drawing. And so this street criminal that thinks he's a scum and knows that he's just got a cousin that's a monkey, what kind of behavior can we expect from him? Will he act like a child of God with purpose on the earth, knowing that his duty is to protect and defend righteousness? No. No, he won't. But it didn't help any when this statement came from a prominent man. I see no reason for attributing to man a significance different in kind from that which belongs to a baboon or a grain of sand. Who would say a thing like that? Well, that was Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes of the United States Supreme Court. During this period of time, it became popular to say man is the center of the universe. And through this explanation that there was no creator, man was the center of all things good and proper. Who did this? Oh, many prominent individuals. And I, a long time ago, heard some words from a man whom I love and respect. And he gave some counsel. He said, there are three things of which we should beware. This is an old man when I was just a kid. Oh, what are those three things? And I didn't really understand them very well. Well, we need to beware of flattery from prominent men. I call that smooth talk. We need to beware of false educational ideas. And they're prominent. They're all over, especially at Berkeley. And we need to beware of sexual promiscuity. And as a young teenage boy, I couldn't have received better advice, but it's taken me a long time to slowly grasp the significance of it. These individuals are some of the many prominent people who have tortured and caused our system of natural law to die. Under their leadership and many others, we started practicing Darwinization of the law, or sometimes called sociological jurisprudence. What does that mean? Well, that means the law is what the judges say that it is. It doesn't make any difference what's written in the Constitution. They look into the penumbras and the emanations. It's kind of like a crystal ball. And there they can see what the Constitution really means today. And when we have Darwinization of the law, there is no fixed, ascertainable truth. It changes from day to day or from hour to hour as they decide what the law means according to what the present needs of society should be. It's a fact. Warping the Constitution undermines rule of law. Robert Bork did an excellent job of explaining this in his book, The Tempting of America. He did another excellent job in his book, Slouching Toward Gomorrah. Good reading. In 2003, he updated his book, Slouching Toward Gomorrah. He wrote an afterword. And in that afterword, he reminded us of the case of Lawrence versus Texas. And he quoted another prominent federal judge, and he said, after seeing what the Supreme Court has done in the case of Lawrence versus Texas, I must say the Constitution is simply gone. It isn't hanging by some small thread, it's gone. That's the opinion of two prominent federal judges who respect and love the Constitution. Where did the Constitution go? Now you all know it's not gone. Why, I even have a pocket copy here. It's right here, isn't it? Isn't everyone following it? We learn they are in school. The Constitution has been gone for many years. Where did it go? As Joseph Sobran put it in his excellent essay, How Tyranny Came to America, he does a good website, sobran.com. He writes, the United States Constitution poses no serious threat to our form of government today. Here's where it went. This man is representative of many of the justices of the High Court. These are the men that betrayed us. These are the men that John Stormer is speaking of in his book, Betrayed by the Bench. Here we have William Brennan. This junk was obviously written by a bunch of right-wing kooks as he throws the Constitution into the trash can. Betrayed by the Bench does a fine job of presenting this. And in his closing statement, he says, understanding where we once were and how we have gotten to where we are today can be used to bring America back again, back to again being truly one nation under God. And he gives some beautiful guidelines in how to do that. Judge Roy Moore writes as the closing statement, there is indeed a cause, and God is waiting for his people to stand in faith, to let their light shine in the darkness that threatens to engulf us. Can he count on you? And Dr. W. Cleon Skousen writes, the only reliable basis for sound government and just human relations is natural law. And we're referring here to the laws established by our Creator God. The laws of nature, God's will revealed in nature, and of nature's God, God's will revealed in the Holy Scriptures. What should we do? Three years ago, I was burdened with a heavy personal problem. And for months I had been praying and asking God, what should I do? And then one morning when I got up from my knees and turned away from the bed, a still small voice told me in my mind, be kind, be gentle, with love unfeigned. Since that moment, I have often thought of those words. I know they came from God. And it was my guide. I'm not going to go about pointing my finger and screaming at people or getting upset or using some form of argument to try and persuade. I know that my Heavenly Father wants me to be kind, be gentle, with love unfeigned as we approach the problems facing our nation. Number two, magnify your calling by sharing with others. We have a duty to perform to conquer the enemy of all righteousness. Hint, start with the milk. Now, some of my friends would be totally scared if they came to a conference like this and heard these things that are being presented. This is not the level for some of them. Some of my friends want to hear the gentle, peaceful things of what to do next. And so I give lessons like this all over the country. So just twice in the last 2 or 3 weeks, I've had these responses. One man says, I want 20 copies, in fact, two different cities. I want 20 copies of the 5,000-year leap. We're going to start teaching that in home study classes. And they will assign different members of the home study group to teach a different principle each month. Two different cities are now doing that. One was a book club. They had a woman's book club, and they decided in the book club, each woman would read the 5,000-year leap. This because it's the milk. It's Constitution 101. It's the beginner's level of try to figure out what to do to restore freedom in the land. LibertyandLearning.com is our website. If you're inclined to see what we do traveling about the country, take a look at this one. Betrayed by the bench. We had 10 takers out there. That number 10 is solved. Let's go to the next one. Okay, if I were an auctioneer, I would go into an auctioneer's voice here. I'm not an auctioneer, so let's just go to the book. I need 10. Now, this is not 10 people. I need 10 people. Yes, I need 10 people, but it's not just 10 books. How do we change the thinking of other good people? Do we hammer on them and jump up and down at the back fence and shout out that they ought to do this and that? No, we got to be gentle and kind. This is a way to do it. And back at the NCCS table, we have 200, am I right? Zeldin, pay attention. Am I right? 200 books? Yeah, thereabouts. Oh, we're down to 70? Is that right, 70? Oh, we only need 7 people to commit themselves. Now, I smuggled 10 betrayed by the bench into my suitcase. I know it can be done. Wrap them in your pajamas, okay? Or some other, thank you, or some other vital piece of underwear, and no one will know that they're there. You can haul 10 home. Don't give me this excuse that you don't have room in your suitcase. Leave something behind. Take some tools. These are tools of freedom, and they are the most fundamental tools you can share with the kindest, gentlest people in your neighborhood, starting with yourself. But this isn't just a read yourself book. It's read and then share. So that's my suggestion. Do I have 7 people that will commit to hauling 10 of these home? Come on, let's see some hands. We've got 1. Come on, Texas, do it for us. You know, a few years ago, you can put your hand down for a minute. A few years ago, I was down in Texas, like 25 years ago, and Ron Paul was in the area. I was giving the conference. Ron Paul came in the back door. Wow, I was excited. Come up, say a few words to us. He was a congressman then, 25 years ago. He came up and said a few words, and afterwards we had a reception. And I remember how exciting that was, and I'm willing to do something like that, but I haven't quite conceived how to do it here. Here's what we did then. At the reception, there were just 20 or 30 people, and I said, well, not that many, probably 15 to 20. I said, I'm not even from Texas. All of them were from Texas. I says, this man is doing what is right. He needs help in the coming election. I will give out, and I got my checkbook out and wrote a check. Okay? And I says, I'll give $100 to Ron Paul's campaign only if you Texans, four of you, will match it. Four. You think they squirmed and wiggled in their seats? Finally, 4 of them matched it. We handed him $500. Now, how can we do that today? I'll buy with my money. How much does it take to buy 10 copies, Zeldin? $50. You need $50 for 10 copies. We got 2. We got 3. Let's do it. We got, counting this lady back here, we got 3. Come on, let's see him again. Let's see him. Hands up. We'll take 10 copies. 1, 2, 3. Come on, we just need 7. Come on, you men. These are all women raising their hands. You men, get into the bidding here. your conscience. We got one back here. Okay, that's four. We got five?
No, 50.
Oh, Tim, aren't you going to commit, Tim?
No.
Tim, I will buy five copies for 10 copies for Tim.
She's buying for me.
She's buying 50. 50.
Are they sold? They're sold. I'm sorry. Tomorrow morning, I'm going to tell the rest of the story. Now, we only got part of it out here today. They've asked me to make a presentation at the prayer breakfast. Which room is it in? I think it's, they told me a different room, but you'll find out as the day goes along where the prayer breakfast is. Please come and join us there. I want you there. Give me some support. I want your prayers. I need that kind of love.
So
we'll be there in the morning. I love you, good people. Thank you for listening today. History. In the dictionary definition, we can read an account of what has happened. Does that mean it's a true account? Not necessarily. Or it's a partial account. Maybe it only tells part of the story, and what they leave out is really the most important part. Or there's another dictionary definition, the story accepted by the public. Now, that's what the history is in our high schools and universities today. It's the story accepted by the public. I like this one. Furious debate informed by evidence and reason. Now that's really what history is. We have evidence, we have the light of reason, and then we discuss and we try and decide what really happened. Only a few weeks ago I gave a presentation at the Homeschoolers Convention in Utah, in Salt Lake City, Utah, at the Salt Palace. And when they asked me if I could fill in, I said, we will give the homeschoolers presentation. I quite frankly believe in homeschool. 35 years ago, when it was extremely unpopular, my wife and I became homeschoolers. And with my degree in education coming from the University of California at Berkeley, I felt qualified to teach my children. Actually, they didn't give me the degree. About that, yeah. At what time where's our leadership to tell me when we're supposed to end?
We'll tell you.
Oh. The next speaker comes on at a certain time, and they were trying to fill in so you didn't feel like you had to walk around and visit all that time.
3:30,
never. So yeah. What time is it now?
It's 2:00. And there's going to be a break from 3 to 3:30.
So do we have enough time for a 40-minute presentation?
Yes, you do.
Okay. Everybody in favor say aye.
Aye.
Good. Oh, no, we don't ask for opposed. All opposed, they left. Okay, the Homeschoolers Convention in Salt Lake each year has the opportunity to interact with one another. And I don't know, any homeschoolers here that have done that before? Have I got any? Sure, one family. That's good. Two families, maybe three. Okay, bless your hearts. Four. They keep going up out there. The topic I chose to speak on is not on homeschool, the hope of the future, but on the empire has no clothes. Now, Tim, are you ready to start?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you're ready, and we're ready back at the back. Charles is. The empire has no clothes. How and why to study history? Now, I travel all over the nation giving lessons on American history, and I have found that some people are offended by what I say. And there's always somebody afterwards that comes up and they say, well, they don't say it to me directly, they tell their friend, and their friend comes up and says, so-and-so's never coming again because you, what you said about such-and-such. Well, now, is what I said false? Oh, no, no, that's not the problem. He just doesn't want to hear it. You understand what I'm saying? So whether I say something true about some individual or some event, if they don't like it, they go, well, I'm never going to listen to that again. We seem to be in kind of a narrow little focus, some of us, in tunnel vision. And so I developed this lesson to try and help prepare them so they weren't so offended by the next lesson. Now, you've all heard the story about the emperor who had an empire, and this emperor was not the normal emperor. He loved new clothing. When other emperors are in their counting house counting out their money, this emperor was in the dressing room changing clothes. He had a different set of clothes for every hour of the day. And then he heard that in his kingdom there were some people who could weave fine cloth. They could weave fine cloth so fine that the cloth would become invisible to anyone who was stupid or unfit for his job. Now, you've all heard this story. Now, I often insert here that these individuals in the empire, these two individuals, were kind, and they were friendly, and they were considerate, and they were thoughtful, and they had other character traits that were admirable, just as many of our neighbors do. But they had one flaw. They were not honest. And so when they advertised this special cloth and the emperor ordered his set of new clothing, soon the final day came, he put on his clothing and he paraded down the parade route. Now, you all remember this, don't you? And I particularly chose this artist illustration because here we have the king stripped stark naked. And what happens but some little child, an innocent, pure little child, all the adults saw the clothes. Oh, yes, they said to each other, isn't that handsome, the king's new clothes? What fine clothing he has. Because they knew if they didn't see clothing, they would be stupid or unfit for their job. Are some of our friends, are you that way? Do we see things we want to see? Like the people that complained about my lessons that on history, they didn't want to see those things that I was telling them, even though they were true. Until one little girl said, the emperor has no clothes. Now, she didn't say that for the whole group to hear, but someone heard her, an adult, and he passed it on down through the crowd. I heard a little child say, the emperor has no clothes. And pretty soon it was going through the crowd. That's what we need to do now. We need somebody with the innocence and purity of a little child to stand up and tell the truth, just like we just heard in this previous talk. That was great. Okay, we'll tell the truth and it'll go. Now, it's going in my circle of acquaintances and friends. I travel about the country and get a chance to teach people. And like Tom DeWeese said, in Las Vegas, there were, what do you say, 1,000 people that don't know you and you don't know them. But we're in the same work. We're trying to preserve freedom in the land. There are common comments that I hear from citizens about the country. See if you've heard any of these. We must support our troops. Or we must support the president. We must support our troops. America is still the greatest nation on earth. Now, these are often the people that are doing very little to try and preserve freedom. And they also say things like, we should be thankful to be under the leadership of a great conservative president like George W. Bush. Now, I'm quoting a United States senator. That's what he said. Okay, that's a Republican senator got up and said that in a public meeting. And then we hear things like this. That was a great ball game last night. And they go off on conversation irrelevant to American freedom. Have you heard things like that? Yes. What is the bare, naked truth? And that's where we need to take this. And we're going to talk about how to identify the bare, naked truth. And when I thought of this, I thought of academic acupuncture. I thought how uncomfortable it is. Now, I've never had it. I'm too chicken. I'm too coward to have acupuncture to help me heal. But my father's had it, and he told me. Yes, son, he said, it's uncomfortable, not pleasant. And so I thought, this is like academic acupuncture. I'm going to try to invite you to let us push needles into you in places that hurt. And yet if we'll do that, we'll start to examine and understand the bare naked truth, and then we'll start to heal. Does that make sense? Now let's go back to this book in 2004. That's not very far back. The Empire Has No Clothes. It was from this book that I used for the title of this lesson. U.S. Foreign Policy Exposed by Ivan Eland. Worthwhile reading. He's starting to tell the truth about U.S. foreign policy. I quite enjoyed the book. Here's another one. The Sorrows of Empire. Militarism, Secrecy, and the End of the Republic. The end of the Republic? Yes, the end of the Republic. Another fine presentation to help us get a grasp on what's happening and has happened to the American Republic. The Empire of Debt. Don't miss this one. The Empire of Debt is not only good fact, it's also delightfully written. I particularly enjoy the section where he talks about America's greatest presidents. Who were America's greatest presidents, he says. Now, he's doing it with tongue-in-cheek in a way, but not really. He says, perhaps we ought to consider the presidents who have done the least. And then he gives the example of Millard Fillmore. Now, I live in Millard County, and the capital of the county is called Fillmore. So this is a good story to tell in Millard County in the city of Fillmore, where we have just completed our 43rd session on liberty and learning. Those are three-hour sessions, and we pound the pulpit for 3 hours each time. Wow. With a little break in the middle for a drink. Empire of Debt, he says, the greatest presidents that ever lived. Consider Millard Fillmore. All that we can give him credit for while he was in office was installing a new bathtub in the White House. And he compares that to presidents who came in and wielded the power to start new deals and dirty deals and other kinds of deals. And when we were done, our republic was worse off than when they started. Now, here's an empire right here. A political caricature is a great way to help us understand our empire. But this one was created in 1900 and published then. We had already started to become a bloated Uncle Sam. And when you read the history, the rest of the story about the Spanish-American War and what we did in the Philippines, it's absolutely disgusting. As this nation imposed themselves upon those people and killed one out of every eight Filipinos in doing so. Wow, that's not the hit. We don't want to hear that part. Pull that needle out and put it back on the counter. This is a truism. Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. Oh, there's the fire. Last week when the fire started, it was a lightning strike 40 miles from my home. 40 miles of rangeland and forest in between us and there. Why, that's no problem, my neighbor said. I have three or four neighbors that, you know, oh, that's no problem. That's under control, 40 miles. Before the day was over, it had swept through our little area there. I don't live in a community. It swept through it and devastated. And that's how some of these wildfires are that we're fighting. If we don't pay attention now and start the battle now, they'll sweep the nation without us being able to raise a defense. Hijacking. When you see that word, when you think of wildfires, we've been talking about the North American Union and the Texas Corridor and these other wildfires. I suggest this is a wildfire. Oh, people all think of 911. Didn't you all think of that? Hijackers running into buildings. No, no, no. Something much worse. Can there be something worse than 911? Oh, there certainly can. It'll make 911 look like Sunday school class. Now, this will be bizarre, and you'll have a hard time. It's like an academic acupuncture needle going in. Can you believe somebody's hijacking our history? And by so doing, can destroy an entire nation? What is history? What are they hijacking? By the way, Hijacking Our History was the title of an article in the Reader's Digest in 1995, an excellent short summary of what's happening. What is history? In the dictionary definition, we can read an account of what has happened. Does that mean it's a true account? Not necessarily. Or it's a partial account. Maybe it only tells part of the story, and what they leave out is really the most important part. Or there's another dictionary definition, the story accepted by the public. Now, that's what the history is in our high schools and universities today. It's the story accepted by the public. I like this one. Furious debate, informed by evidence and reason. Now that's really what history is. We have evidence, we have the light of reason, and then we discuss and we try and decide what really happened. Can anyone really write down history? Can you write down an event that's past? No. All you can do is look at what evidence there is left over from that event and then try and record. Maybe it's a diary, maybe it's a journal, maybe it's footprints in the sand. Whatever the evidence is, then you bring that out and you try and decide what happened. This, don't put that one up yet. Ralph Reichel, history professor, asked his students in a class, "What's history?" And one of the students responded, and he published it in a book, "It's just one damn thing after the other." Well, maybe history's all of the above as we examine history today. And so when you look at books, and by the way, Zeldin has three books back there left. Zeldin, how many books, The Making of America, do you have? That's the one that I, the second one, after the 5,000 year leap, the next project we created was The Making of America. And I have the honor of being in the introductory among with 100 other people as helping on the staff. That was a great experience also. We tried to write a true history of the meaning and essence of the Constitution in the tradition of our founding fathers. Well, that was, I mentioned in the earlier lesson, that all started for me in this little old concrete block garage. Then we came, go back to it. What do you want to go back to it for? You should all go and do this. It's a good experience. I'm serious now. I'll come anywhere in the United States and give this series of lessons, which can take from 1 hour to 18 hours, whatever, 30 if you want. You've got to have an audience and a room. I won't do it outdoors. That's where we did it. That's my life was changed in that room. And I was so grateful and so grateful for that experience. Now, this great book is one of them that came forth. We had The Rising Sun on the front cover. That was a new edition. See if we can get to the next slide here. Some things are true whether you believe them or not. Now, that's on the billboard going into a little town near where I live. It says that on a great big billboard. I don't know what they're trying to tell. Just that somebody decided to spend the monthly fee to keep that out in front of the public. Some things are true whether you believe them or not. Do you believe this? Is this true? Now remember, I am one of the world's gurus on, what is that? That's a printing press. Is it true? See, history isn't always written. Sometimes history is objects or it's things or it's drawings. This is one of the very earliest drawings of a printing press. Is it true? Come on, somebody verify, stand and swear. Yes, I know that's true. Well, you all agree it's a printing press. I mean, we haven't had to work too hard getting you convinced. I want to tell you, that printing press is a mess. That's got all sorts of deceptions in it. Let me use the printing press to liken to written history that we're confronted with daily. Let me give you an example. This portion of the press is completely missing. There's something supposed to be there, and it's not. The artist blew it. Do you suppose the artist did this on purpose? I doubt it. No, he just sloppy art. He just didn't draw the carriage. The carriage is essential so that when you finish pulling the bar, which this man is doing, and then you slide out this big heavy stone that weighs 200 pounds, it has something on which it can rest. And that's called the carriage. Well, there's something else about the press that's missing. It's missing the till. Well, who would have known that? And does it really matter? Without the till, you cannot convert rotary motion to linear motion. Oh, yes, we're trying to convert rotary motion to linear motion and make an impression. It won't work without a till. But there's even something worse. It's all screwed up. The screw goes up instead of down when he pulls the bar. You can't print with that screw. That maybe is where the phrase came, it's all screwed up. I don't know. The story accepted by the public. That's it right there. That's how history is presented to us in our high schools and universities. Just like that printing press. Let's take some illustrations here. Historical blackout is illustrated by no carriage and no till. Historical blackout means they left it out. Can that change your viewpoint of history? Oh, yes. Now there's something even worse than that. This part that screwed up. That's bad because they said it wrong or they presented it wrong and we trusted and thought it would be right. That's called false propaganda. We get plenty of that. We'll give you some illustrations here in a few minutes. And these together cause historical brainwashing. Now, these are not my terms. These are terms in history books that tell about bad history. Like you can buy a book called History. It's the history of history. That's worthwhile reading. And there are other books that talk about how history is written. the gigantic faction of 1861. Okay, we have this rectangular portion of our printing press that is missing, and I thought, well, we'll liken that to some written history. What is the gigantic faction of 1861? What is it? It's just one of the most, the biggest calamities ever to take place in the nation, that's all.
Amen.
Yeah, somebody knows what it is. Two or three of you do. Well, if you haven't learned about the gigantic faction of 1861, you don't understand American history. You don't know what happened to our republic. This can be found, but it's not easy. It requires going beyond the normal level of reading the newspaper and watching the evening news. Here, for example, is an excellent presentation on the gigantic faction of 1861. It's called The American Union, written by James Spence in 1862. Now, that was timely, wasn't it? 1 year after this faction took over, he wrote the story of what happened. This is an eyewitness account. This is good history. I don't have time. I'd like to spend an hour on it and give you a full book report. Ugh, I bite my tongue and go on. Well, we won't go that far, though. How about, let's see if I missed one. Yeah, we missed the, notice the year on this. 1863. It's another book giving details about the gigantic faction of 1861. Excellent reading. Again, an eyewitness account. The true nature and character of our federal government. A critical review of Joseph Story's commentaries on the Constitution. Good reading. But how many Americans have ever heard of this before? This is historical blackout. I'm giving you an illustration of that. Is Davis a traitor? There's another excellent treatise on the gigantic problem in 1861. Notice when it was written. Actually, the man had died when it was published. Albert Taylor Bledsoe was Secretary of State. All these authors, by the way, are credible authors. These are not kook authors. These are fine scholars, and they write credible history. It's just been blacked out. Now, here's a modern one, 1998. He's still writing on the same subject, The Gigantic Faction of 1861. Excellent treatise. Lincoln, the Road to War by Frank van der Linden. Hope you meet him someday and thank him. Here, notice we're getting closer now, 2005. Another book on the gigantic faction of 1861. Now, history is what? Evidence combined with reason and debate. What is the evidence? Here he decides to do something the two authors did. They decided to go to all the newspapers of the time period of the gigantic faction of 1861 and read them. Now, they're still there. You can still go to microfilm libraries and find the sources and read the original newspapers. And then they use the newspapers to tell the story. Hadn't been done. It hadn't been done yet till 2005. In 2006, another author writes yet another book on this gigantic faction of 1861. Now, I'm trying to show you that there's plenty out there, but as far as we're concerned as a public, we're ignorant. We are completely, totally ignorant of that time period as far as truth goes. Now, the till. Let's liken it to something. The missing till. This is more missing history. Let's liken it to the great gold heist of 1933.
Yes, sir.
Who knows anything about the great gold heist of 1933? I see three, four, five hands about out there. Six, there are a few more. This subject needs to be understood. But because of historical blackout, the American masses have no knowledge of what happened. Well, these are some of the people involved in the great gold heist. Does that look like a bunch of thieves? Actually, that's in the United States Mint, and they've just robbed the American people of their gold. And they've taken it and confiscated it. And then after they confiscated it at $20.67 an ounce, then they announced the gold was now worth $35 an ounce, and they robbed us of 40% of our wealth instantly, overnight. Who was the thief that created this gold heist? Thank you. Most of the American people have never heard of the gold heist in any language they understand. They think this was a great movement to improve America and get rid of the Depression. Nonsense. Now you can read it. It's available. This is an excellent treatise coming from the Mackinac Center and Lawrence Reed, a fine economist, The Great Myths of the Great Depression. Or you can read from Murray Rothbard, another fine scholar, What Has Government Done to Our Money? And then this excellent treatise, this one will entertain you. It's must reading. empire of debt, the rise of an epic financial crisis. Debt is not a godly thing. Debt is of Satan, and it'll bring us down to the worst depths of hell. Debt is not good. And now we have what? I can't even comprehend it. Neither can any of you in here. What the national debt is and what promises we've made and how we're advancing that as each day goes by. Go back to the printing press. Let's talk about this portion right here. False propaganda. How about the supreme fraud of 1945? Huh? What could that be? What is the supreme fraud of... I get these out of reading books, these titles. I'm not clever enough to come up with them myself. The supreme fraud of 1945. Now, if there's a supreme fraud, there must also be a supreme law. A supreme law of the land. And we can read that supreme law of the land in the United States Constitution. And Zelda Nelson has a few hundred back there. We hope everyone doesn't leave without getting at least one copy, or maybe 10 or 15. Okay, this is the supreme law of the land. Well, what is the supreme fraud of the land? We heard that last year in the closing talk in Kentucky, for those of you that attended this convention. It was one of the finest speeches on the topic I've ever heard. And that was Herb Titus. Two contrasting charters. The supreme fraud of the land is that the United Nations Charter was created, and it's higher because it governs what the government does today rather than the Constitution of the United States. And he did a splendid job of contrasting those two charters. Who were the chief architects of the United Nations Charter? We know who the chief architects were of the supreme law of the land, men whom we still hold, should hold in love and respect, like George Washington and James Madison and on down the list of these beautiful people of the... Who were the authors of the supreme fraud of the land? I heard some of you know. See, you're an unusual audience. This is not the normal American audience here. We have all sorts of interesting personalities, like the United Nations Convention taking place, and who was the chief architect over this convention? We would call him the first Secretary General. You've already said his name, Alger Hiss. Well, who was he? We heard last night. He was a communist spy, a high-ranking officer in the State Department, and sent there by the top leaders of the United States. Well, he wasn't the only one. There were at least 17 additional communist spies sent by the United States government to go represent us at the convention in San Francisco. I have the list. Go to my website. 18 that we've identified so far. This is our delegation to write the United Nations Charter. Now you go to your local school, and what are they doing there? Oh, they're holding mock United Nations Day in honor of this wonderful event, this great historical event where all the nations can be supported and joined together in harmony and peace. We weren't the only ones sending communist spies. Who is this? Yeah, this is Joseph Stalin sending V.M. Molotov. V.M. Molotov, another evil man. Now, if there were a Guinness Book of World Records at that time, who would win the position of the most murderous dictator in the history of the world? Joseph Stalin. And Joseph Stalin was our ally. He was our ally in winning the war and suppressing tyranny. Isn't that what we were told? That's false propaganda. We didn't suppress tyranny, we built tyranny as we came to the close of the war and wrote the United Nations Charter and began sending supplies to Joseph Stalin. We were the perpetrators of the enslavement of 700 million additional people. Now, where is this story told? Whose high school history book or college history book tells this story? See, we get false propaganda, historical blackout, and other ailments of history that lead us astray. Well, last year at the Freedom 21 conference, we heard this great presentation from Herb Titus. And since then, with his permission, I put it on my website. He didn't do it to my knowledge. I put it in written form. And you can read that great speech. Go back. Find it. LibertyandLearning.com. Herb Titus, two contending charters. The United Nations Charter is Satan's program. It's based on rule of force. The Constitution of the United States is God's program based on the laws of nature and of nature's God. Well, we're back now to another printing press picture. Remember, I'm the world guru. Now, that's no kidding. I just sold a printing press in Canada. Last year, we sold one in Australia. The year before, in Switzerland. These are all extremely carefully built, one at a time, custom-made printing presses. And I just taught book history at Texas A&M University down there in May. Second trip to Texas this year. Okay, so when I speak of presses, that's a subject I understand. Well, this is a better drawing. You notice on this press, he has the carriage. Ah, now we can pull this big heavy stone out and it has a place to rest. Oh, what a pleasure. And we now have the till. This is the till that converts rotary motion to linear motion. Oh, what a relief. We now have a press with a till. But uh-oh, guess what's up here? That's a cherub. That's a little sweet cherub. The little sweet cherub is hiding the screw. The screw is still screwed up. Can you see the threads? It's backwards. Oh, well, this we call, let's see if we call it something here, historical whitewashing. Now, these are terms from history, the history of history. Okay, when we cover the screw with a cherub and a little sweet angel smiling at us and we can't see the screw anymore, at least we don't see it very well, maybe we will think the screw is correct. But in fact, it's historical whitewashing. Now, the lofty goals of the United Nations were announced during the debates on House Resolution 2745 in the year 2005. Tom DeLay, you remember him? Mm-hmm. Tom DeLay said that the goals of the United Nations were to prevent wars, protect human rights, and advance the cause of human freedom. Have you ever heard anything like that? That's what every high school and every university in the nation teaches. What is the truth? Do you suppose that V.M. Molotov was going to try and prevent war, protect human rights? Do you suppose that Alger Hiss and the 17 communist spies from America were going to try and prevent war? Nonsense. Total nonsense. The United Nations was a vehicle to promote perpetual war, which it has accomplished ever since. Oh, this one is a relief. Now we can see a real accurate history of printing press history. This is the best one I've ever seen of an antique old printing press. Here the historical artist has not only done a correct rendition of the press, every detail is beautiful. They have also laid the parts out on the floor and they've lettered them with the letters of the alphabet showing where they go. So each part except for the dog fits into the press. This is the bare naked truth. Now, there are two things to beware of when we study history. The side that wins the war writes the history. And truth is the first casualty of war. Now, those two things we have to beware. An example of Civil War history. The War for Southern Independence is a more accurate description of that war. Thank you. I'm never sure if I'm going to get rotten eggs or not when I say that. The Civil War freed the slaves and saved the Union, which justified the cost in lives and property. Now that's a quote out of history books. Many of them say that in various ways. Is this true?
No.
When we apply all the tests of history, is there any fact in that? The story accepted by the public is what this definition is. This is the story accepted by the public. Remember the two things. The side that wins the war writes the history, and truth is the first casualty of war. Now, was it a war of Southern rebellion, or was it a war of Northern aggression? First time I ever heard the words, the war of Northern aggression, it was from Congressman Larry McDonald. You may have been there, Bert, up in Idaho. Congressman Larry McDonald, one of my great heroes in American history. Any of you know him? Yeah, you heard of him. He got killed by the Soviets. Some people called it murder. The airline in which he was flying was shot down by a Soviet jet. Congressman Larry McDonald was a fantastic supporter of constitutional government. He was a Ron Paul. He was the pre-runner, forerunner to Ron Paul. And the part that startles some people is, he was a Democrat. And he supported constitutional government 100% of the time. Well, he was the one that I heard this term, in Idaho Falls, Idaho, he said, and that was the war of Northern aggression. And I thought, what's he talking about? The Civil War, we won it. We freed the slaves and saved the Union. That's what I thought then. I've repented since then. This author, John Dwyer, I do believe he's in Texas. John Dwyer, now I preface this remark by saying that thousands upon thousands of books have been written on this period of our history. Thousands of them. Many of them erroneous in part, some completely. We can't read them all. I've read 14. And I'm starting to get a grasp now of what happened. And yet, after all of those thousands of books, one historian says he estimates between 50 and 70,000 books and papers are written on the so-called Civil War. And in 2005, John Dwyer decides that they hadn't done a good job. So he writes another one. What I liked especially, and I'm really, really pleased with his book for most part, what I liked especially was he's trying to balance. Instead of giving the side that won the war writes the history account, he has an account that gives both sides equal time, just as he does on his front cover. To understand the causes of the Civil War, look for the answers to two separate questions. Why did the Southern states want to leave the Union? Why did the Northern states refuse to let them go? Now, I'm not trying to teach this period of history. I'm giving you an example of how history suffers from historical blackout, historical brainwashing, historical all the other causes. History is not always what it appears to be. Oh, here we have an illustration, a wonderful illustration from a famous artist, and he's done an excellent job, and he has illustrated a soldier from every single war in which America has ever engaged. Huh? Am I telling the truth? Every single war in which America, what's this soldier represent? World War II. That's the last time we ever fought a war. That's the last time Congress ever declared war, and from then on we followed the United Nations. Oh, is that true? Any evidence of that? Smile, it can't be this many. Why do men go to war? Will you go to war if there's not a noble cause? Well, you've got to have a noble cause. And so in the propaganda created to support a war, noble causes are always presented to the public. For example, The Illusion of Victory, an excellent book on the First World War. The Illusion of Victory. Does that sound like this man thinks we won? No, he doesn't think we won. The author is a highly credible historian named Thomas Fleming, and he wrote the book and published it in 2003. Excellent reading. Why, he said the noble reason we were told we were going to war was to make the world safe for democracy. Do you know that in Karl Marx's Communist Manifesto, he says that democracy is the first step to communism? Huh? That's what's in there. Karl Marx said it was the first step, and now we're going to go out and prepare the world with democracy. Oh, it must be some different kind. Another noble cause published and promoted during the First World War was fight the war to end all wars. Well, we've all heard that. We'll never have another war if we just go fight this one. That's why we're over in wherever, you know, wherever we're beating people up right now. This is going to be the end. We're going to control it all. And fight a war without hate. I love you, brother. Bang, bang. Okay? This is a war without hate. Now, to be able to accomplish these noble goals, we have to advertise and get recruits. This is called false propaganda. This is a poster put out by the United States government to raise money to pay for the war. Halt the Hun. What's a Hun? Oh, it's not just a German. It's a bad German. Here's the definition of a Hun in the dictionary. Any savage or destructive person, a term of contempt applied to German soldiers in World War I. Now, what is this Hun doing in this poster? Yeah, he's doing something very terrible. And what is this noble Marine doing? He's halting the Hun. See, those Huns were wicked, bad people. Is this true? Were the Huns really wicked, bad people? Be careful now, because my ancestry goes back to the Huns. I spent 2.5 years in Germany with the Huns. I found only kind, gentle people for the most part, with one exception. I remember one man, when I entered his room, he invited me to come into his home. And then he said, sit down. And then he started beating his fingers on the table in front of me. And he said, Hiroshima, Nagasaki, screaming at me. Is that your message? Needless to say, I left. That's the only one that treated me unkindly. Those people are people like us. And if we had time, we'd tell the story of the Christmas truce of 1914. And if we had time, we'd sing Silent Night, as the Holy Spirit of God came down to both sides, both the Allies and the enemy, and they came out in the field between the two trenches, and they embraced and they shared heartfelt feelings, and they said, you're just like we are. We're not the ones fighting. It's those people back in the back offices that are telling us to fight. What a marvelous story that is, the Christmas truce of 1914. Well, this propaganda program went on. Remember, I'm only giving you little examples of the kind of history and the problems we suffer when trying to study American history. The propaganda went on. The President of the United States, Woodrow Wilson, at that time, he hired a propaganda specialist named George Creel. And George Creel started creating different kinds of propaganda. Among those, he created movies. This is the third United States official war picture. And you'll see George Creel's name down here. Under Four Flags, as we present to the American public the noble cause for fighting World War I, a war without hate. It'll be the war to end all war, and we'll promote democracy throughout the world. Have you heard anything like that lately? George Creel did something else. He hired 75,000 four-minute men. And that's what they were called, the four-minute men. Maybe you could get employment as a four-minute man. Your job would be to go down to the local Lions Club or the Kiwanis Club or the Exchange Club, or maybe they'll even give you 4 minutes at Freedom 21. And in those 4 minutes, you explain the great and noble reason why we need to send men over to fight in France to fight those wicked Huns. And that was their job, to convince the American people to enter into World War I. This is part of our history. Do you feel an acupuncture needle in your arm at this moment? Yes. All the falsehoods and the sham in writing history did not go unnoticed by Henry Ford. He is to have announced. I say he is to have announced. He may have announced. Who knows? Do I have any evidence? No, I haven't seen his handwriting and had it proven. Remember, history is evidence combined with reason and debate. He is reported as having said, history is bunk. What do you suppose he meant? Well, it's so poorly written that it's unreliable. He may have meant that. Writing history, to try and get a grasp on this, let's put it on a continuum. Now, a continuum is going to show two extremes of how history can be written. Hopefully, they will write it at the one extreme. That means tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth. So help me God. That's what we want. And we call that end, and you better take a note on this one, heuristic writing of history. Heuristic is a word we particularly chose so that you wouldn't know its meaning. And now we can define it for you. Heuristic writing of history is contrasted to aristic writing of history. And again, we carefully chose these words, my research consultants and I. And now we're going to explain these two ends of the continuum. Heuristic, helping to discover or learn the facts. Seeking truth. Now that's what we want our histories to do. Discover the facts, seek the truth. Now, I'm sure no history book is perfect, but the concept's got to be in the author's mind. I want to tell the truth, and he has to work diligently at doing it. Now, contrast that to aristic writing of history, fighting with words. Now, these are out of the Oxford English Dictionary. Fighting with words. Oh, we're going to use words to fight? Remember George Bernard Shaw, the famous English playwright who was also a founder of the Fabian Socialist Society? He was the one that said, words, words, words. All we have to use is words. Going to fight with words. Specious reasoning. Specious reasoning. specious seeming to be good, sound, correct, logical, etc., without really being so. Heard any, global warming, Al Gore, that's specious reasoning, that's an excellent example of it. Boy, he was a smooth talker last night. Specious reasoning. Now there's one more aspect. Oh, here's an example of specious reasoning, and you'll have to go home and figure it out for yourself. When I make my normal presentations, I challenge the students to finally, perhaps for the first time in your life, to do some original primary research. And we make it easy for them. Go to the Liberty and Learning website, on the home page, and you will find a challenge. And the challenge is, do a heuristic exploration of the term the Union. Huh? Everybody knows what the Union is. Do they? Which history book did you read that gave you the definition of the Union? The side that won the war? If you read the side that won the war, you better go do your research in a primary source, not from some filtered through the eyes of a historian book. These two books give you an example or a chance to do that, a heuristic exploration of the Union. You can start with these two books. I don't know how my time's coming, so I won't probably give a book report on them. Remembering that specious means seeming to be good, sound, correct, logical, without really being so. There's one more part to heuristic writing of history. Victory is more important than truth. Now we have several books, I have several books on my shelf that are written about the lies that have been told by current politicians. Historians, people interested, they start collecting these things and then they put them down as evidence. And they say, here's the time, the date, and the place when Bill Clinton said such and such, and now here's the time, date, and place when he said something else. They're conflicting, so either one or the other was not true. That's the kind of evidence they present. And they can write hundreds of pages with that kind of evidence on it. Okay, victory is more important than truth. The Manual of Citizenship, I'm going to give you an example. This will be the one that shakes you up the most. If you haven't got an acupuncture needle in you now, you will have in just a moment. Academic acupuncture. The Manual of Citizenship Training, U.S. Government Printing Office, 1927. Now in this case, I asked for the Special Collections Library to obtain the original. So I didn't have to use a copy filtered through a historian's typewriter. And I read the original manual. I testify, this is what it says. Now, I'm only giving you a tiny bit of pages and pages. This is 1927. This is what we want our troops to know. This is what we want them to believe when they go to fight for the United States. The government of the United States is not a democracy, but a republic. Now, isn't that clear? Does anybody have any question about what that said? What are the principal characteristics of a democracy? Demagogism, license, impulse, agitation, discontent, anarchy, chaos, and socialism. Ooh. Do you think the soldiers had any question then? Now, these are only two sentences out of several pages on the subject. It was very clear when I got done that the soldiers would go out knowing that America is a republic. Well, that's called heuristic writing of history. The author tried to tell the truth. 25 years later, and I shared this one in the last hour, but it'll make much more sense now. 25 years later, the Army Field Manual of 1952 declares, because the United States is a democracy, the majority of the people decide how our government will be organized and run. The people do this by electing representatives, and these men and women then carry out the wishes of the people. Do you see any contrast? They're absolutely opposite. Can they both be true? No, they can't both be true. Can they both be false? Yes, they could both be false. But I want to suggest to you that the first one is true and the second one is false. Which one is taught in every high school and university in America today? The false one. We have a problem. This is called heuristic writing of history. You're going to go home and use those words now on your next door neighbor? Let me give you a little heuristic history. Well, now we're back to the emperor again. The emperor is going down the parade route. And we know that he has no clothes. Expose the bare naked truth. That's what our duty is. We've got to start telling the truth. We must learn the truth ourselves. And then we must share it with others. Teach the American view of God and government. This is the introductory lesson to a longer series about the American view of God and government. We present that under the title Liberty and Learning. We cannot be ignorant of the principles of freedom and remain free. Assignment? And I'm willing to invite you to do it too. Do original research. Now we're talking about original research, but we make it easy. You can go to the website, push the keys, and the original research comes up on your computer screen. My friends that do the website, they said, we can't make it too hard or they won't do it. So I ask you, do a heuristic exploration of the words, the Union. Go to libertyandlearning.com and follow the directions. Study the 5,000-year leap. Now, this is your homework assignment. Study the 5,000-year leap, and Zeldin held 30 copies back. You still got some back there? Two. He says there are only two left now. He also told me he will ship to you at no charge for shipping. Anyone that orders the copies, 10 or more, he will ship them at no charge. There are two left now. So study the 5,000-year leap. Organize the Know Your Liberty series in your community. Oh, that last one, you won't be able to do that unless you come to Utah. I'd love to have you come, and I'll take you on a personal tour of the Crandall Historic Printing Museum, where he teaches the coming forth of the Holy Scriptures, beginning with the Bible. And we had the privilege of building the Gutenberg interpretation of the printing press. For those of you that are in Houston, I've contributed down there 3 presses to the Houston Historic Printing Museum, and one of those that I'm most pleased with is the Gutenberg interpretation of the printing press. For those of you in Buena Vista, California, go to the International Printing Museum, and we contributed, they paid me, I didn't mean contributed, we did the time and the labor and built another beautiful exhibit of the Gutenberg Bible printing press. But guess what? Nobody has the slightest idea of what it really looks like. And so I have to preface all that. It's not really a replica press. It's an interpretation of what may have been done in the years 1450. Oh, do what Moses did. I don't know when these slides have come to an end. Maybe I never ended it. I was pondering one day, and I thought, you know, there's an example in the Bible that tells us what to do. When we're in this terrible dilemma that we're in America, a nation of ignorant people, illiterate in our history, completely and totally illiterate, and yet we live in what's called the information age. Moses, in the 5th book of Moses, called Deuteronomy, said, "These be the words which Moses spake unto all Israel." And then he gave 20 pages of their history. And he told the good and the bad. And they had to listen to it because it was their leader telling them. It was like academic acupuncture for them also. An old adage, a people must from time to time refresh themselves at the wellspring of their origin, lest they perish. And that's a good place to stop. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I was impressed in my heart that something good had happened and I needed to know more and be a part of it. But it happened because a neighbor came to me and said, why don't you come? In fact, it was a little more persuasive than that. He says, I said, I don't think I can afford it. I was really just trying to get out of coming, see. How much does it cost? Oh, it's $35. Now, that's back when $35 meant a lot. And I says, I can't afford it. And he says, I'll pay your way. And I'll be over at 6:45 to pick you up. Now, that's how we need to bring people into the freedom movement. I'll be over at 6:45 to pick you up and come with me. Come to whatever it is that you're sponsoring in your area and influence their hearts and change their lives. And he did that for me. And here I find myself at age 66 with my gray hair and wrinkles now, same age he was then, just hoping and praying that somebody's heart will be touched.
Praise God.
Like he touched mine.
Praise God.
Why God is twice while he was away, but the fact that he was away doing work connected with the Constitution, he has dedicated his life to the fight of freedom and liberty. And so he's being blessed, he's almost saved, come within 100 yards of his home and his shop.
Wow.
And his son was there and helped fight the fire, but the log buildings around him burned up, and just a terrible devastation. So that was a miracle, and we want you to know. And also our friend from Idaho, Zelda Nelson, another holy man that spends all his time and health and fortune in the freedom of business. He and his had a big fire there. He's a driver. And his grain is all ready for harvest. And the fire burned right down to the crop line, and they got it out. And they were exhausted. They went to bed and let the BLM take care of the fire that night. So they, under their great wisdom, let it burn some up on the mountain again to get rid of some more cedar trees. And went around, got away from them, burned up another man's big grain field. So they never used the best judgment because they're government workers. Anyway, we're so happy to have Stephen Pratt. He has given thousands of lectures, and all of his life is dedicated to the large work, freedom and liberty. So we'll now hear from Stephen Pratt.
I am delighted to be here. I don't know if you're going to be able to hear over in that corner. Can you hear over in that corner? We're going to try and share some thoughts, and the first one I want to share is from Tim Smith. He's I met him last year. We've had a delightful year as we've associated over the telephone, and he's produced good materials to distribute for other people to enjoy. Tim came up this morning, and he said he was reading last night from Psalms 19, and he shared this with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Hallelujah.
I read that this morning. I thought that's the message I needed this morning. And so I have this heavy feeling of responsibility to try and share with you something that will uplift and strengthen, that when we leave this room, we will be better people, and it's a burden of responsibility to do that. And so we'll try and accomplish that goal. As we try to do that, Zelda Nelson, my dear friend of 30 years, he says, give some gifts out. And so he offered these gifts. And This is not an easy gift to receive. We need 10 stout-hearted, what?
Men.
No, not men. We need any good people. God created man, male and female created he them. We need 10 stout-hearted men. Okay. He wants to give. This is a package which we've been sharing this year, and I couldn't believe it. A year ago, Zelda says, I think we want to distribute 100,000 DVDs of More Perfect Union. Now, many of you have seen it.
Yeah.
100,000. I thought that'll never happen. How will we ever? Well, we've distributed 400,000. But we need to distribute 10 million. Well, this morning we're going to give away 10 sets. It's his request that I do this. 10 sets. This is the package we sent. I'm sorry, I didn't get involved as much as others, but this is the package that he organized to volunteers, and they sent 100,000 out, one to every school in the United States. I weighed this on a scale, and I calculated 17,000 pounds of mail was sent out, one to every school. But some of the schools, the teachers will still have never heard of the package. It's a great beginning level course, the milk of the constitutional period. The Constitution, a teacher study guide, all packaged up here, sells for $40 retail. He wants to give away 10 of these right now to the first 10 stout-hearted people that raise their hands. Yeah, they're going to hand them out right now. Raise your hand. Keep your hand up until they're all gone. So what we want you to do is give them to a school teacher after you've enjoyed it yourself. Pass them on to a school teacher. Megan Hedges, you got that one, right? Looks like we're going to get 10, more than 10 stout-hearted people here. That's great. Can we run out? Are we out yet? Is that the last of them? Okay, we just gave out 15 stout-hearted people. We thank you for your support there.
Thank you.
Now, from that, there are 15 people that will receive a gift from you, from your heart, as you try to explain the importance of sharing the great message of freedom with a school teacher or a school. We've had this happening all across the country. It continues to explode, and as the 100,000 copies went out, that was the beginning and not the ending of this great project started by Zeldin and Bert Smith. What is the power of your influence? I don't know anybody in here particularly well, but I kind of have a feeling that I'm among just good common people. I don't see any great leaders of the world here, you know, any dignitaries. We're just people. We're citizens of the United States. And what does it require to be a good citizen? We're going to talk about that for a few moments here. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for just a common citizen that lived in my neighborhood that said, "Why don't you come and listen to the story of America?" I told that part yesterday. That was 35 years ago. 35 years passed, and the old man got older, and he finally reached age 93. And is you 93 yet? Don't think so. And at age 93, I thought, well, I better go visit him again. For 7 years, I'd worked with the old gentleman full-time, and he had been my great mentor and teacher. And I often have said that next to my own father, he's probably the one that's influenced my life the most. There are some others that come really close, though. One of them is this dear man right here, Bert Smith. Thank you, Bert. So on that first night in the old concrete block garage, I was impressed in my heart that something good had happened and I needed to know more and be a part of it. But it happened because a neighbor came to me and said, "Why don't you come?" In fact, it was a little more persuasive than that. I said, I don't think I can afford it. I was really just trying to get out of coming, see. How much does it cost? Oh, it's $35. Now, that's back when $35 meant a lot. And I says, "I can't afford it." And he says, "I'll pay your way. And I'll be over at 6:45 to pick you up." Now, that's how we need to bring people into the freedom movement. "I'll be over at 6:45 to pick you up and come with me. Come to whatever it is that you're sponsoring in your area and influence their hearts and change their lives." And he did that for me. And here I find myself at age 66 with my gray hair and wrinkles now, same age he was then, just hoping and praying that somebody's heart will be touched.
Praise God.
Like he touched mine.
Praise God.
Now, at age 93, I kept contact with him all those years after the 7 years full time. And at age 93, just before he passed away about a year and a half ago, I thought I'd better go see him again, get some more advice. Of course, we didn't know when he was going to leave. And I had a big speech to give. Big means I had an important responsibility. And I felt this burden of what should I teach? All the years that we'd been together, he nurtured and coaxed me in how to teach the constitutional history of the United States. And we had teached that from coast to coast and in two foreign countries. He'd sent me 6 times to Canada, back when Canada was working on a constitution. So here I am standing now before this grand old gentleman. He doesn't know I'm coming. I just knocked on the door and popped in, you know, just dropped in to say hello. But my purpose was to ask him, what should I teach at this great convention from people from all over the United States? Now I visited the light talk for a few moments and then I sprang the question on him. What should I teach? And without hesitation. Now he's 93 years old. He's given thousands of speeches. He was a popular speaker when he was in his 20s. And he's been all over the world speaking. And I thought, boy, I'm gonna get real wisdom here now. What will I teach? Will it be about the First Amendment or about the, you know, some constitutional principle? And without even hesitating, as if he'd known weeks in advance that I was coming, and he prayed and meditated and prepared for the answer, he quietly and calmly said, testify of Jesus Christ. Yeah. That wasn't the answer I expected.
No.
And so as I prepare the lessons now, every time I go out, I try to bring in the testimony of Jesus Christ. I call that a witness of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It matters not what the topic is. And so we will do that this morning if we can. And hopefully with your love and your prayers, we can have a feeling that will strengthen us all. Years ago, I was in this community lecturing for this grand old gentleman. And our topic was the one we always gave, the making of America. And it had at that time a name, The Miracle of America. And we had an 18-hour study class, and we went through that over a period of several days. And often you became bonded to the good people that came to the class. And it was exciting to teach and exciting to feel as we associated one with another. I got done with one of the lectures in Dallas, Texas, all 18 hours of it. And on the front row, there were two distinguished gentlemen wearing suits and ties each day. Now, most of them came leisure, like you know, comfortable clothes. But not these two. They had on their suits and ties, like Zeldin right now, like Burton. They looked just like that. They were astute and interested. At the end of the program, right here in Dallas, one of them came up and said, we're so-and-so, and they introduced themselves. We're administrators at the Accelerated Christian Education Schools. What is that? Would you like to come and visit our school? Right here in Louisville, Texas. It's just a few miles away from here somewhere. Yes, I'd be glad to. I spent 4 hours that afternoon in this beautiful environment with wonderful experience. They had 250 people in the home office. Since then, they've moved the main office over to Tennessee. But this experience was glorious. And they appointed a young lady to guide me through, to give me the tour. It wasn't the mature adults. They appointed a young lady. And she was about 17 years old, and she did a splendid job. She said, now this is the part of the school where we learn to read. And there were quite a few smaller people in that room, not divided by school, not divided by a class, but by the skill of reading. Here we learn to read. And then she walked through a door, and she motioned, and here is the room that where the class is held, where students have learned to read, and now they're reading to learn. Okay. And there were 70 students. 70 students and one teacher. Now, I am a trained public school teacher, and I know that that's an impossible ratio. Why, no one can teach 70 students. That was the most organized and best behaved classroom I have ever seen. I spent 4 hours watching and soaking in this great experience of private enterprise teaching people through the highest state-of-the-art methods. It was good. And right at the end, as I was about ready to leave, and one of the unusual things, I see the students out playing on the playground, all ages from kindergarten to seniors in high school. And I see sisters playing with their little brothers. Now think about that. You're at school and you're playing with your little brother?
That inspired me that day.
But I think the highlight of my visit was the 17-year-old girl's witness of Jesus Christ, and here's how it happened. I said, "And why are you at this school?" "Oh," she says, and she stood up a little taller. Now, I'm the dignitary. I'm the big dignitary here, you know. And she's a little bit smaller and lightweight. And she stands up tall, and she looks right up into my face, and she says, "I'm preparing to be a missionary for the Lord Jesus Christ." And that was a joyful experience for me, and I've never forgotten it. She made me feel kind of little.
Yeah.
I want to mention some things today about the superlative. The superlative. That's the best, the greatest, the fastest, the strongest. All these things that we call superlative. What is the greatest event ever to take place in the history of the world? What is the greatest sermon ever spoken? I'd like to make mention of these things today. As a researcher at the Freeman Institute many years ago, one of the magazines I was invited to read was the Moscow News. Now that's straight from the Soviet Union, Soviet propaganda. And I remember one article that stayed in my mind all these years, written by Dr. Peter Reshtov. And I'm sure if I could speak Russian, it would be something like this in English. He says, "The greatest event," now this is a direct quote, "the greatest event ever to take place in the history of the world was the Socialist Revolution of 1917. Now, can you believe that? That's what we're supposed to believe. The greatest event was a socialist revolution. They had just gone through Russia and killed everyone that resisted, and they said this was the greatest event. And now they're going to impose upon them the Marxist doctrine of the Communist Manifesto. Wow, I've remembered that all these years, because I don't believe that's the greatest event, and you know that it's not. Another great superlative, we'll name the greatest event here that I'm sure you all, many of you feel comfortable with. Let me name another one, the greatest speech that was ever given. My father is 95 years old. On March the 14th this year, we held his 95th birthday party with 95 of his posterity present, of the 150 that could have come. He has grandchildren and great-grandchildren. I think he's even got 3 great-greats, as I remember. It sounds impossible, but when you're 95 and the children marry young and they have it seems to work that way. And so this grand old man, he comes up to the podium. He's very bright and alert still. He has his cane there, and he leans on his cane, and he grabs hold of the mic stand so he won't fall over. And then he tells the story that I'm about to tell. Now, I've heard it many times or read it in his journal. But he tells it again. He wants his children and his grandchildren to hear the greatest sermon ever given. And it came from his grandmother, Eunice Peterson. Now, Eunice Peterson died anonymous, just like most of us will. Nobody but your nearest family will come and show up and say goodbye. Eunice Peterson was the wife of a rancher. And they lived out far from town. Now, far from town in those days was really far. It was 20 miles of dirt road. And they had no vehicles to get to town comfortably. When my father moved there, he was 5 years old. And he said, "I sat on the wagon axle." Or actually, he said it was too rough to do that. There wasn't even a box on the wagon. He said, "My mother sat on the axle of the wagon and held the baby." Now, can you think? An iron-wheeled wagon bumping over the rocks and dirt for 20 miles so that you can take your wife and family to the homestead. It was on the Columbia River in the state of Washington, and only recently I was up there lecturing in Portland, and it's only 200 miles from Portland. I thought, man, I'm almost home. Malaga, Washington. Windswept, dusty, cold in the winter, hot in the summer. This was home, and they loved it. This was their home. You're from Washington, right? On the Columbia River. Well, Grandma Peterson, without help, prepared the meals for the summer hay crew. Now, the summer hay crew was 8 to 10 men, and they lived there because it was not convenient to travel back and forth. They were full-time employees through the summer. Can you imagine feeding 8 to 10 men 3 meals a day, and they sleep in the building next door? And you have no refrigerator, you have no electric or gas stove, you have no running water. This was the condition. You don't even have a kitchen. All you have is a table in the middle of the room with a little bin on it they called the flour bin. And you opened the flour bin and you scooped out and grandma made homemade bread. These were the good old days when you made pie for breakfast. I like that. And my dad was 5 years old, and his mother and father lived about a mile away, and they were part of the haying crew and worked together with the grandma and grandpa. And he says he loved to go visit grandma. Now my grandchildren, our grandchildren live about, well, I have several families, 600 yards away. And they love to come visit grandma. They don't come visit me. They come visit grandma. And grandma fixes them cookies and milk and all those things that make grandma so well loved. And so this little boy, he always wanted to come visit grandma, and he liked to sleep upstairs in the little attic. Now this is one of those houses that's made of boards nailed together with newspaper glued on the inside to keep the wind from blowing through the cracks. I don't know, have you even seen that kind of a house? Yeah, you've had one. So he's up in the attic and he comes pitty-pattying down. And now who gets up first in the morning on a ranch like this? Grandma. And who goes to bed last at night? Grandma. She's washing the dishes, she's preparing the food. Now the men work hard too, but grandma's responsibility is feeding these people. So grandma's down there, he says it's early in the morning. He says, I don't even think grandma knew I was there. She was over at her table kneading bread, and she had on an apron. She always wore an apron, and she'd often wipe her hand. Now this is the middle of July. The stove is going full blast. Bacon's cooking on top, pies are baking in the oven. She's getting ready for the crew to come in that are out doing the chores and feed them breakfast. And he says the aroma was wonderful, and the warmth and the feeling. And grandma loved to sing. And on this morning, she was singing one of his favorite songs. And he said often when she sang this song, tears would come into his eyes. I'll take you home again, Kathleen. You remember that one? Well, she stopped right in the middle of the song. Now she had flour on her head, she had on this flowery covered apron, she's singing this song, she thinks she's all alone, and she raises her flour covered hands up to the ceiling and she looks up and says, oh, how I love my Lord Jesus. And she put her hands back in the flour and started singing right where she left off. Now he told this story just a few weeks ago on March the 14th to the family reunion, so that the next generation would know that their grandpa loves the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says as a little boy, he wrote this in his journal later on, he says as a little boy, I didn't know who Jesus was, but I knew if grandma loved him, so did I. I love the Lord Jesus Christ because I love my father and mother, because they taught me and guided me by their examples and the way they lived. And I grew up in a home just like he grew up in a home. Eunice Peterson, thank you, wherever Amen. You are.
Amen.
Now, where did Eunice Peterson learn to love the Savior? She didn't just get that out of the air. We passed that on from generation to generation. And it's our duty to do that.
Amen.
So each generation will grow up to love the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Well, that event I wanted to share with you today. That was my father on his 95th birthday said that to this day. And I must add, he became a great seminary teacher and a teacher of religion. He became a wonderful speaker traveling across the country. He's listened to great speakers from many different areas. And he says to this day, that's still the greatest speech I've ever heard. Oh, how I love my Lord Jesus. Seven words. Yes. What greater speech could there be? For when we love him, we keep his commandments and bring joy and peace to ourselves and those around us. Wow, we could end right there, couldn't we?
We love the brethren too, amen.
We haven't named the greatest event ever to take place in the history of the world. We found out it wasn't the Socialist Revolution, or I hope you just determined it wasn't the Socialist Revolution of 1917. I've had the privilege from time to time of speaking on Easter Sunday, and I had that privilege this year. And I thought, can I say these things in a church? Can I mention the Socialist Revolution? But indeed I did, to contrast the power of Satan versus the power of God.
Yes.
And as we came to the end of the talk, I announced with boldness, the greatest event ever to take place in the history of the world was the death and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen. That's true. Hallelujah.
Now, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. And I hope I have the stamina, if they were to line me up in a firing squad, to stand there with my head up high. I hope they have that ability to proclaim to the world, I am not ashamed of my Lord. In closing today, there are two things I'd like to do. One is we need to sing a hymn. That's another thing I've added to all the lectures now on American government, American history. We try to sing a hymn at the end. So I've handed one out. And this is not just any old hymn. This hymn has a history. Now, has Jim come yet? Our gifted singer, he's there. Now, I want you to join me when we get ready. I'll introduce it for a moment, then I want you to come. I need a strong voice to help me through this.
Right.
If I can find my version of it here. I did actually memorize it. But I memorized the wrong verses. I memorized a modern version. And then I went back and I found an 1878 hymnal. This is a Methodist hymnal of 1878. I was trying to find in my study of history a version of this hymn that was close to the Civil War period, because I had read in an account written by John Dwyer called The War Between the States, America's Uncivil War. John Dwyer told us there that Robert E. Lee loved this hymn. It was one of his favorite songs. And one evening, as the soldiers were camped, about 2,000 of them, on a hillside with their fires burning and they're sitting around their campsite waiting for the battles the next day, one of the soldiers started singing The Firm Foundation, Robert E. Lee's favorite hymn. And then the rest of the soldiers joined in. Now, they had no piano, they had no organ, they had no harmonicas or whatever. They were singing a cappella. That's what we're going to ask you to do today. And they sang the hymn with the Spirit of God in their hearts, knowing that God would strengthen and bless them. A hymn from the heart is like a prayer unto God. Now, another great event took place in 1898. It was Christmas morning. 35,000 soldiers spontaneously began to sing The Firm Foundation as they were gathered around Havana, waiting for the battle to begin. So this twice I've been able to find a use of this hymn to strengthen the armies that were there, that felt they were in the cause of right. We are an army, and we need strength in the cause of right. And so I would like to ask Jim to come up and stand beside me. I practiced one verse last night trying to get through it okay. This is a hymn that when my wife played the music, it was obvious it was not any hymn that we had used the words to before in our congregation. In fact, it was, "O Come All Ye Faithful." Now that's the hymn tune that is in the 1878 hymnal. So we're going to be trying these words to the tune, O Come All Ye Faithful. And I presume we wouldn't want to sing it too fast. So it's going to be, are you going to hide behind me?
No. I'm your underpinning.
You're my underpinning.
I'm right behind you.
So let me try, and then you correct me if we're too far off here. We're going to sing the tune, O Come All Ye Faithful. So each time I start this, I have to say, let's see, how does that go now? Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Okay, now that's the tune.
That's good.
Now we're going to, is that okay?
That's about perfect.
That? Now we're going to try the words of The Firm Foundation. That was the name of the hymn. How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord.
To you, for refuge, to you.
and sanctify to thee, and sanctify to thee thy deepest distress. Thy soul that on Jesus hath leaned for repose, I will not desert to his foes. That soul of hell should endeavor to shake.
In some far-off spot. I always think it must have been South Dakota. Remote, forlorn, windswept, and bare. Any of you here from South Dakota? That describes it, I tell you. We'd had one of these wonderful moments where we spent several days together teaching. And at the end, you bond. You bond. No matter who the good people are, if they're good people, you bond. You feel this warmth and friendship, love for one another. And this one leader of the group, he was the chairman. And over these days, I wished I could remember his name, over these days we have felt this feeling of unity. Now I knew he wasn't a member of my faith, and that's totally irrelevant.
Amen.
We loved each other. And we got to this busy airport, if it's possible. I have a busy airport in South Dakota. I keep wondering about that. There must be a busy airport because it was busy. There were people coming and going. There was noise. There was confusion. And he said to me after we visited for a moment, it was about time to go to catch the plane. He said, "Would you pray with me before we part? I'd like to offer a conversational prayer." And I'd never heard of such a thing. A conversational prayer? What's this guy about to do? And he started talking without any act of piety. Not to try and draw attention to anyone looking at him to think he was doing anything unusual. He stood there by me, and he started to pray, as if God was standing right beside us. And I've never forgotten that. It was another one of those special moments. And I'd like to offer a conversational prayer. I'd like to invite you to stand beside me, right here. Just stand up at your chair. I dearly enjoyed the Baptist minister, Chuck Baldwin, recently, as he approached prayer. He said, "Please stand as we approach the throne." The different ways that we have approaching God in prayer. And a conversational prayer, he didn't close his eyes, but I've always closed my eyes, and I have a hard time thinking, how do you not close your eyes? I love this dear man. I'm going to offer some thoughts that are just kind of a medley of thoughts coming from some great sources. And a prayer for us here in our conference at Freedom 21. Dear God, we the people here at this Freedom 21 conference in Dallas, Texas, gratefully acknowledge the blessings of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as creator, preserver, and ruler of the universe and of these United States. We hereby appeal to him for mercy, aid, comfort, guidance, and the protection of his providence as we work to restore and preserve these United States. Our great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians, not on religions, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. For this very reason, peoples of other faiths have been and are afforded asylum, prosperity, and freedom of worship here. This is a choice land, and whatsoever nation shall possess it shall be free from bondage and from captivity and from all other nations under heaven, if they will but serve the God of the land, who is Jesus Christ. America needs men and women of great moral courage to become involved in the political process. But moral courage of itself is not enough. We need men and women of great moral courage who have prepared themselves with a working knowledge of the principles and practices of freedom as contained in our Declaration of Independence and the Constitution of the United States according to its original intent. We do not have the luxury of retiring to our own private cloisters to pursue only our own private special interest. Strong voices are needed, the voices of those that have prepared themselves with a working knowledge of our organic documents of freedom. The weight of the stance we take may be sufficient to tip the scales in favor of truth and right. Dear God, please assist us as we depart from our Freedom 21 conference, that we will take thy spirit with us, the spirit of peace, the spirit of kindness, the spirit of love, and that in that spirit we will affect those that are in our circle of influence to raise and strengthen them by being in the presence and in thy presence. We pray for this humbly in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.